Well, after an inspiring lecture from Jack Alakovich, former professional basketball player and head coach of Radio Farm Ulm in Germany, who I had, the honor to work with a few years ago at Football Club Barcelona, it's time now to talk about sports psychology. Psychology is considered as one of the key factors to achieve optimal performance and well-being in sport. This is why it is so important to work on the mental side of the game. Today, as an ELPA Performance Advisory Board Coordinator of the Sports Psychology area, I have the honor to introduce you to Professor Isabel Balaguer, a worldwide renowned sport psychologist. She's professor at the Faculty of Psychology at Valencia University and director of the Research Group of Sport Psychology. She has 134 papers published and 38 book chapters. She's a member of several scientific associations, and she combines successfully research and applied work. She's definitely a referent in sport psychology. Today, she's going to talk about motivational climate, which is a psychological environment that coaches create to motivate players in training and competition. And she will talk as well about how coaches can choose the best motivational climate to make a difference and boost the performance of their teams. It is an honor to have Professor Isabel Balaguer with us. ELPA and me personally, we want to thank you for being here and share your knowledge with the basketball community. Let's welcome Professor Isabel Balaguer.
Hello, good morning. Thank you very much, Mar, to introduce me and to invite me to this venue. I'm really happy. It's a pleasure to participate in this first edition of the Performance International Congress of ELPA. When Mar Rovira invited me to this venue and asked me about the title for the presentation, I didn't have any doubt. I think that this is really, really important topic for the coaches, how they create the motivational climates and how they help or they don't help the players to reach the high performance. So I has been thinking the way to transmit what is important for the elite athletes, for the elite coaches to understand what we propose. And we all know that when the athletes set their goals, they really work hard. They reach one goal, they set the goal, they set another one, they are in the process. And during this process, they are gaining in expertise and in mastery. So when we are interested in how the athletes reach their goals, how they work in this process, what helps the athletes to really be resilient, to be really interested in what they are doing, to be working hard, then we know that in this process, motivation is really important. This is very clear in this quote from Luka Doncic. As he say, a champion needs motivation above and beyond winning. It's like motivation, we know that is like the fuel of the engine, is the what make us move, what make us to be inspired and to be active in what we want to reach. When we talk about optimal functioning, it's like when we observe the players and we see that they work hard in training and competition, they recover from mistakes and don't fear failure, they keep wanting to improve, and they maintain confidence, they are resilient. They embrace the challenge. What we want to say in these cases is that really they feel that they can reach what really is important for them. In this quote of Kobe Bryant, we can see what it reflects for a player that is really involved in what he's doing. It's like every negative pressure, challenges are all an opportunity for me to rise. For them, in this situation, is that they are really involved in what they are doing. It's like we know so far, and this is what we are going to defend, that motivation is very important for optimal functioning.
Mm-hmm. And Isabel, we all know that motivation is important to reach optimal functioning, optimal performance, as you just said, but the concept, it might be quite abstract. How could players and coaches identify motivation, and how can coaches promote it?
Very important question, Mar. We talk about this several times, how difficult it is for them to know if they are motivated, they are not, if this kind of motivation is going to help them in their everyday training and in the matches. And I'm going to explain, to give some definitions that make coaches and players understand what is good about motivation, because motivation is not always good. There are moments that promote this optimal functioning, other times not. So let me present what motivation is and how the coaches and players understand the motivation. We know that and when we talk to the coaches, when we talk to the athletes, they say, I have a high or a low motivation, and they talk about quantity. And if we look, this player is advancing with confidence, we can see that he's performing well, that he seems into it, is involved in the playing, in the game, but we don't know why the player is motivated. When we want to know why, we need more than one thermometer. When we are in this direction, we can look in this picture. I think that is very clear. What is above the water, what we can see from the iceberg is that the player was performing well. Seems that it was into it, but we don't know the reasons why the player is motivated. So, you know, when we talk about these aspects with the athletes, it's like if we ask the same athletes we have as reference, and we say, what are the reasons why you play basketball? And he say, I enjoy playing basketball. Generally, this basketball player thinks, feels, behaves in a way that makes the performance more likely, feels good about himself when playing basketball, beyond performance. Playing basketball promotes his well-being, and this is a very important point in the high performance, is embraces the challenge and thinking the pressure is a privilege. Not all the athletes have the privilege to have the pressure. And another point for the coaches and the players, looking to the same player. When we ask, why do you play basketball? And he say, I enjoy it. Or say, I value what basketball contributes to my life. Is he plays basketball because he wants to. This is what is quality motivation. But if he say, I will feel guilty if I give up because I invested too many years of my life, and if I give up, then I will be feeling guilty what I did, why I'm giving up, or only moves, because we know that the elite athletes also move for external reasons. But when they move only for external reasons, for results, having a reward, then when they has to, no, because it's not self-determined, we know, we talked several times about this, then the quality of motivation is low. So we know in this way that motivation is going to be related with optimal functioning, optimal performance. So which are the keys that we need to explore to promote the motivation? That is the other question that you were asking before, no? How we can promote the motivation in the players. And then appear a very important part of this process are the coaches. The coaches are really, really important for them, because they are in the training, in the matches, when they travel, and what they think, how they reinforce them, this is going to be really important for the players. Well, I think that I don't need to give the name of this important reference in the world of basketball. But for us to know what he say is really clear. Is a coach must never forget that he's a leader and not merely a person with authority. And this is what the coaches, I think, need to know, how they really can direct, help, interact with the athletes to reach their objectives. And this is the objective. For me, for many years, when I talk about leadership, and we ask about what do we expect from a leader, from a coach, then there are at least two important points. It's create the environment for individual team members to develop their full potential, but also to create the environment which optimizes players working as a team. Coaches in general, we want, and we know that this is what works, that creates the atmosphere to get the best results from the individual and the team. Is what we want, that is efficacy and enthusiasm from the players and from the teams. And this is what coaches have a very important role. When we explore, because you know that I like research, mm-hmm. One thing is the theory, and this is what we think, what we can see in the place where we go, matches, it can be training. But when we go to the research, there are some colleagues that they explore what the elite coaches from different sports, team sports, talk about how to create the best atmosphere to get the best from each player and from the team. And they say, obviously, there are different styles, different philosophies, and from high facilitative, empowering, to more autocratic, amiable, dictator. And also, and we talk about this several times too, mm-hmm. Misconceptions of some coaches who believe that the authoritarian style is the best. When we ask these coaches what is the best from a coach, then we know that they say effective coaches listen to players' ideas with a view to developing respectful relationships and comfortable and enabling team environment. We know in this situation that we need to explore the climate. We need to explore what they really do, how they really behave. And in this case, we go what you say in the introduction, and I say the same, how important the climates that the coaches create are for developing the best from the players and from the team. But when we talk from a motivational approach, we are talking about the coach-created motivational climate. And what is this? This comprises what a coach usually do and say. And when we say usually, is what the players kept, what can be in the bus, in the plane, in the breakfast, can be in the training, in the matches, but they are always commenting what they did, how they did. And if we have to give some definition, is how coaches interact with their athletes, provide feedback, evaluate, respond to desirable performances, and react to mistakes, negative performances of their athletes. How they react, if they made a mistake, if they did well, how they interact. This is what really, for us, is really important.
Mm-hmm. And Isabel, I have another question for you. Mm-hmm. Elite coaches have their own philosophy, this we all know. They have their own conception about what is the best way to coach their teams, as you just pointed out before, to keep them motivated. Everybody does what they know how to do best. But how can they identify the motivational climate we were just talking? And how can coaches can see the effects that this motivational climate has on the motivation of their players?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very, very important question, because I know, and we talk several times, sometimes we are really theoretical and we don't go to identify the cues to detect the dimensions of the climate, how a coach can realize what he's doing, how he's doing. Well, in this, I think this model that John Duda developed some years ago is going to be very clear for us to understand. This is coming from important theories of motivation, and we are going to distinguish two dimensions of the coaches. One is empowering climate, and the other is disempowering one. So I'm going to talk first about the dimensions, and later I will talk about the effects on the variables that you ask about, no? Why these dimensions can impact in the optimal functioning in the quality of motivation. But first, let me present for detecting this, how the coaches create an empowering climate, task involving climate, what this means, autonomy support, and high social support. When we talk about high task involving, and we want to know, and we want to detect what are the dimensions, we know that the coach create this climate when value, working hard, and improving. When the coaches emphasize cooperation in the team. And a very important part is that the mistakes are viewed as part of the process of improvement. And when we talk about this, when we talk about these aspects, and I think that for us it's going to be clear, and we know from the beginning, like high level players know that effort, improvement, and striving for mastery lead to good performance. And I choose these two quotes, one from Ricky Rubio, that is clearly what he thinks about what is the competence, mastery competence, task-oriented. The more I train, the luckier I get. And when we say before that the coach think that the mistakes are part of the improvement, I think that this quote of Michael Jordan is very clear. I missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and miss. I fail over and over and over again in my life, and that is why I succeed. I think that it's very important to know that to be a great player, you need to understand what is the way. And the coaches can help, or they can break this process. And in this situation, when we are talking about research again, not only about quotes, we know that task involving climate predicts optimal functioning. In this research, quantitative research, we can have like how the task involving climate, when they are in the training, we are almost there, we are really reaching the point, you are doing really well. This makes autonomous motivation or gives the information about how they have to improve what they are doing. And when we go to the elite athletes and we ask what made them to do their best, and you have these qualitative studies, then you find the same. They want this mastery climate. So this dimension is important. I think the coaches can understand very well why this works and in this direction. Another part of empowering climate is how the coaches give the autonomy support. And the coaches give voice and choice. They listen. They want what the athletes think, what the players want to do. And the players, when they feel in this ambient, they are feeling involved in the training, they are feeling involved in the matches, and they are more creative, and at the same time, they are committed to their game. So for us, this is really important. And you know, we talk about this point.
No, we talk about so much because you know, I have a concern because I've been involved in elite basketball forever, I would say, and I've seen how elite coaches behave, and I have a concern, and we've been talking so much about that. And the thing is, some coaches, believe, because we had these deep conversations, they believe that they can lose power if they give autonomy to their player. Some might even think that they put their responsibility aside, or that maybe that they are not good enough, or that the players should be controlled. So this is something interesting. What do you have to say about it?
I think that sometimes the coaches are afraid to lose their power. And this is what happens sometimes. It's like, if I give autonomy to my players, then where is my power? And thinking in this direction, I found a quote it's very good, I think, that express the importance that the coaches give, how important is that the coaches give autonomy support to their players. Because if you give autonomy support to the players, let me see what Mike Hogg, New Zealand International Women's Basketball, say. He said, giving autonomy to support my players is not divorcing my responsibility as a coach, but allowing the players a greater role in the decision-making process, having them accept a greater responsibility for the team effectiveness. So if they give autonomy, no less affair. We are talking about giving autonomy. They decide and they are involved. They are with more involvement in the game. So more responsibility. And this is the same that we have when we go to quantitative studies. It's like when the coach gives autonomy support, it's self-determined motivation, it's more quality of motivation. They develop competence, autonomy, relatedness, and even well-being of their players. So I don't know if this clarifies your point. I think that it's not easy. It's not easy. You need to understand why, how, and but it works. We know because we have research in this point, and we know that this works. And there are another part that even some, I think some coaches can be thinking, yeah, and works too. It's like when the coaches are socially supportive. They are there for what the players need. We know that players need to know coaches care about them before they care about what coaches say. When the coaches provide caring concern, they know that the coach care about them, then the players feel that they are valued and they are respected. And these parts are really important to feel the belonging. They belong to the team. And when you belong to the team and you really are with high cohesion in the team, then we know that task cohesion, that is in our Spanish team, we saw several times that this works. And then is when the players really reach the best performance. So for us, if we go again to the research, we know that when you go to an Olympic medalist or you go to the experiences that elite athletes have, they say the coach matter. What we want is that the relation with the coach is trust, respect, they believe each other, or they desire training environments that are caring and supportive. So in this situation, what I want to present briefly is this model that clarifies what you asked me before, is when the coaches create these empowering climates, they, at the bottom, we have optimal functioning. But this is because there are all one mechanisms, mediation mechanisms that make that this is clear. I'm not going to explain because we don't have time, mm-hmm. but it's really important, the process in this direction. In general, we are working now with questionnaires that are collecting empowering coaching, empowering climate, like a whole. And the results are telling us that when they create these climates, they develop autonomy, motivation, enjoyment, players feel competent, well-being, and team cohesion. And when we go to the other part, that for me is unbelievable, when the coaches have plenty of information about how important is the empowering climate. I really don't understand why they create this empowering, where they humiliate and they really don't treat it with respect to the players. Because in this way, what they reach is, I say, compromised functioning in the way that is difficult functioning from the athletes, because they promote what is the controlling motivation. I mean, low quality motivation. In this way, when we talk about disempowering coaches, we talk about ego involving, and these coaches only value the best players, mm-hmm. punish mistakes, the opposite that in the other case, and the players in this case only feel that they are good, they demonstrate superiority to the other ones. And the other dimension, the high controlling, that control doesn't mean that you really organize, you are worried, you have like a structure in your training, in your matches. This means that you humiliate, this means that you want, that you pressure the players to act, think, or feel in a specific and prescribed way. It's in the way that the coach wants. Don't give the freedom, don't give the possibility to be autonomous, like we say. So this is because the players feel like a pawn on the chessboard, and they feel incompetent, they feel unimportant, and disconnected from the coach. Mm-hmm. This situation, as you know, create maladaptive and negative responses, low quality motivation, ill-being, anxiety, burnout, dropout, and low cohesion. Mm-hmm. In sum, we know that empowering climate are creating adaptive positive responses, and disempowering climate, maladaptive negative responses. In this direction, it's obvious that we ask about how we can support and educate coaches in creating more optimal motivational climates. And in this way, when we go to the research and we ask about what we know about educational programs, educational workshops, there are some researchers that they review what is going on, know what we have, and they finally conclude that theory-based rather than theory-inspired coach education interventions are required. We don't have too many theory-based workshops for the coaches. And one of them, as you know, and I'm working in this for several years, mm-hmm. Almost decade, is empowering coaching. Empowering coaching is a theory and evidence-based program for coach education. And in the workshops, very dynamic and interactive. And this is one of the questions that you asked me also when we were talking, preparing, what are the aims that is covered in empowering coaching training? Well, it's very important that the coaches understand the differences in quality of motivation. We talk about this. Other point is how the coaches are aware of what and why in the good practice work, and understand what are the principles and the implications of empowering coaching behaviors. We also are interested making the coaches reflect on the coaching practices and identify behaviors which can be disempowering and why they are disempowering. And also to work when they are planning how they create more empowering and less disempowering climates for players in training and in competition. And finally, and very important too, when you see, okay, this is very good, but I have this barrier or the other barrier, well, it's important between them and they do, how can find solutions in regard to these barriers to being more empowering and less disempowering in coaching. Empowering coaching, as you know, and has been published, has been tested in different European countries, in England, France, Greece, Norway, and Spain, in the PAPA project. It was involving nearly 10,000 children and their football coaches. And what we know is when the coach was more empowering and players become more autonomous, motivated, players enjoy the game more, players exhibit higher self-esteem, reported higher subjective vitality. And these findings were when controlling for country. When we see the implications of the intervention, children whose coaches attended the empowering coaching training, they perceive the climate on their games to become less disempowering. The coaches learn to decrease the disempowering aspects. However, this wasn't, they didn't find this in the ones in the control group. And finally, when the players whose coaches have attended the workshop, they reduce their intentions to drop out. Very important in all the periods, as you know, that you have researched in this topic. And finally, I want to present some pictures, what we are doing now in empowering coaching in different countries. In Spain, we had in tennis, multisport, in UK, in Mexico. We had feedback from different coaches that received the workshops, and really, really, they were pushing. I don't know if this gives an idea of what we do in the workshops. And what is important to say is that we have from the grassroots, what I presented, to elite level. And in all the cases, we have to say that motivation is a process and doesn't matter if we are talking about children, we are talking about medium level, or we are talking about high level. When you really feel with quality motivation, what you really feel that you really want to do what you are doing is when your functioning, your psychological functioning is optimal. And this is what we have to do, at least to help coaches to create this kind of climates. And I hope that we talk, you and I, we think that is important. I hope that is we gave the ideas in the way that the coaches and researchers that are here with us today can understand and can be useful for them.
Thank you very much, Isabel, for this amazing presentation. I think you contribute, or at least you light a light in order to fight for motivational climate, empowering motivational climate, because it's really useful. And elite coaches and elite athletes shouldn't be afraid of using it, because at the end, it's proof, because the research said so, that boosts performance. And you know, in elite sport, what we need is to improve performance. So thank you very much for this presentation. It's been an honor for us to have you here today. We are really, really grateful. Thank you one more time.
Thank you to you and to the organization for inviting me. Thank you.